Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Chemistry for Breakfast, The Amazing Science of Everyday Life by Dr. Mai Thi Nguyen-Kim, narrated by Raechel Wong. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to illustrations, figures, and diagrams present in the print and ebook formats of this book. Foreword. I was a pretty ugly baby. I was born with jaundice and refused to eat or drink. Seriously concerned, my parents did everything they could to feed me as much as possible, and continued to do so long after my health improved. As a result, I became a real butterball. When my hair began to grow, I developed the asymmetrical receding hairline of an elderly man. Naturally, my parents thought I was the most beautiful baby in the world. As a chemist, I sometimes feel like the mother of an ugly child whose beauty only I can see. Most people see chemistry as evil, poisonous, artificial. Or they remember how much they hated it at school and couldn't wait to drop the class. Convincing these people that my baby is beautiful is a science in itself. At best, people have no idea what chemistry entails. They look at me wide-eyed and clueless and ask, "And what can you do with chemistry?" Sometimes I'd like to shake them by the shoulders and yell, "Everything! Chemistry is everything!" For example, delicious food is one of my earliest associations with chemistry. My father is both a chemist and an excellent cook. He told me that all chemists are good cooks. If you can't cook, then you're not a good chemist. When I started to develop an interest in cosmetics at the age of 13, my father was able to explain everything involved there too. The chemical structure of color pigments, how volumizing hairspray works, and the pH value of face cream. For me, chemistry has always been part of everyday life. Since studying chemistry, I have been beyond help. Whether I'm drinking coffee, brushing my teeth, or exercising, I think about adenosine receptors, fluorides, and metabolic enzymes. If I go for a walk in the sunshine, I think about melanin and vitamin D. If I cook noodles, my mind turns to boiling point elevation and starch polymers. And I've become a pretty good cook, too. I wouldn't be a good chemist otherwise. Many people have very specific ideas, not only about chemistry itself, but also about the people who work in the field. I'm often told that I don't look like a chemist. The success of the Big Bang Theory may have made it socially acceptable to be a nerd, but it also showcased many cliches. For example, that it's categorically impossible to be an expert and have social skills. This is just one of the many cliches we scientists have to fight. Scientists are unfamiliar creatures who spend their lives in laboratories or surrounded by bookshelves. Nobody knows what we look like, whether we have hobbies, or whether we even have friends. Are scientists humans too? There's just no way of knowing. During my doctorate, I decided to start a YouTube channel called The Secret Life of Scientists. I wanted my videos to give a face to science. I didn't just want to show how cool science is, but how cool scientists are. This mission is like a complex research project, and I'm still working on it today. I now also produce the MyLab YouTube channel for the German content network Funk and present the German TV series Quarks. So why write a book as well? Because I want to really let off some steam. This book invites you into my chemist's brain and provides a brief insight into my everyday life as a science journalist and YouTuber. Above all, however, I want you to listen to this book, look deep into the eyes of chemistry, and succumb to its irresistible charm. And if I'm right to believe that humans are curious creatures, then listening to this book will show you not only that chemistry really is everything, but maybe even how beautiful this science can be. 1. Obsessed with chemistry. Bring, bring, bring! I almost fall out of my bed in fright. My heart is racing. Furious, I want to scream, "Matthias!" But my linguistic faculties don't quite seem to be working yet. My body's in a strange sort of limbo, halfway between dozing and hand-to-hand combat. I throw myself at Matthias / his cell phone and flail around until I manage to turn off his awful alarm. It's 6 in the morning, damn it! Matthias has a terrible habit of getting up in the middle of the night to go running at least twice a week. Well, I consider 6 a.m. to be the middle of the night. Unfortunately, this always means that I need to wake up slightly before him so that my day doesn't start with an influx of stress hormones. I prefer to be woken by a barely audible tinkling, as if by a fairy. Otherwise, I start my day with palpitations. But Matthias needs at least 100 decibels and this awful bring, bring, bring to wake up at all. So, I usually set my alarm for 1 minute before his to mentally prepare myself for the stress. Last night, when I set my alarm, however, I didn't know he was planning to exercise so early this morning. I opened the drapes to reduce Matthias's melatonin level. "Matthias," I eventually managed to say. He mumbles, still half asleep. Unbelievable. The molecule melatonin is also popularly known as the sleep hormone. It's produced in the pineal gland, a small gland in the middle of the brain. There's a very good reason for its nickname. Melatonin plays an important role in our circadian rhythm, from the Latin circa dies, around the day, our internal sleep-wake cycle. The higher our melatonin level, the more tired we feel. Conveniently, light helps to reduce melatonin concentration, and it finally seems to be having an effect on Matthias. I feel compelled to see the world in molecules, but it's a nice feeling. Basically, I'm obsessed with chemistry. It makes me sad to think about all the non-chemists going about their lives, not thinking about molecules at all. They don't even know what they're missing. Ultimately, anything that interests you as an individual can somehow be explained through chemistry. And you, dear listener, are in fact nothing more than a mound of molecules, learning about molecules. And chemists are mounds of molecules thinking about molecules. It's almost spiritual. So what does my morning look like in molecules? How well we wake up in the morning is largely determined by two molecules. We need less of one, melatonin, and more of the other, the stress hormone cortisol, which is automatically released in the morning. Stress hormone might not sound great, but a moderate amount of cortisol helps us to get going. Normally, this wonderful service provided by our body doesn't even need an alarm clock. The bring, bring, bring may have been a bit too much, and has triggered an actual fight or flight response in my body, an ingenious emergency system, tried and tested since primeval times to save us from mortal danger. Like pain, stress is generally a welcome bodily response. Pain tells us that something isn't right, and stress helps to save our lives. Imagine that you're walking around in the Stone Age, and a saber-toothed tiger crosses your path. Saber-toothed cat would be more accurate, but tiger is more dramatic, so let's stick with that. If your body didn't immediately release a flood of stress hormones, you'd stand there looking stupid rather than reacting quickly, grabbing your spear, fight, or climbing the nearest tree, flight. We must assume that the saber-toothed tiger also experiences a fight or flight response. It has never been established whether humans really were a meal of choice for saber-toothed tigers. After all, humans were predators too, and an encounter like this one may have been a meeting of two hunters who respected one another. In any case, the fight or flight response is older than the human race, an alarm system installed in many creatures. And how does this alarm system work? Through molecules, of course. The molecules lying dormant in our bodies first need to be roused by some sort of trigger. In the Stone Age, this might have been a saber-toothed tiger. Today, it's Matthias's monster alarm clock. The clock's acoustic signal sends a nerve impulse from the brain to the adrenal glands via the spinal cord. Along with the pineal gland, the adrenal glands are among our body's most important hormone factories. This nerve impulse causes the adrenal glands to release what is probably the best known stress hormone, adrenaline, which is promptly pumped into the bloodstream and makes its way to various organs. A hormone is nothing more than a messenger substance, a molecule that carries important information. And in this case, the message is panic! While adrenaline is rushing through the bloodstream and disappearing just as quickly, another hormone is gearing up for the stress war. ACTH, adrenocorticotropic hormone, is produced in the pituitary gland, and travels through the bloodstream to the adrenal glands, the base camp for the fight-or-flight battle. As soon as it arrives, ACTH unleashes a whole chain of chemical reactions. I like to picture it like an epic movie battle scene. Adrenaline is the forerunner who raises the alarm, while ACTH is the army commander who raises their fist and lets out the first battle cry, mobilizing the army and setting the carnage in motion. Finally, cortisol enters the bloodstream and makes its way to various organs as well. Hormones can trigger a variety of physical reactions. Symptoms of a fight-or-flight response include an accelerated pulse, greater blood circulation in the muscles, run! Reduced blood circulation in the digestive system, drop everything, we have more important things to do, deeper breathing, dilated pupils, sweating, goosebumps, and heightened awareness. All these physical reactions to the release of my stress hormones mean that I am now, of course, wide awake. But the feeling of mortal danger isn't exactly pleasant. I can't blame this on molecules. Our bodily chemistry is designed for survival. The poor stress molecules don't know that Matthias's alarm isn't threatening my life. They just want to help. The problem is that our modern world is full of stress. At school, at work, in our relationships. But very few situations are actually life-threatening. At least, not acutely. Chronic stress definitely has an effect on our health. Luckily, to ensure that we and our molecules don't crack up completely, our stress system has a negative feedback loop that makes sure our body doesn't totally escalate and work itself into a panic. Among other factors, this is down to cortisol, the stress hormone with self-discipline. While adrenaline charges through the bloodstream once and then quickly disappears, cortisol stays in our system a little longer, ultimately inhibiting the release of ACTH and thus the production of cortisol itself. For contrast, let's look at a chemically perfect morning. While I snooze, the sun's first rays shine through my eyelids onto my retina, which is connected to the brain via the optic nerve. In the brain, the production of the sleep hormone melatonin is now inhibited in the pineal gland. The pineal gland is indirectly connected to the optic nerve and is sometimes referred to as the third eye. This might sound esoteric, but there's something to it. In amphibians, the pineal gland is directly sensitive to light and really does act like a third eye. While my melatonin level slowly decreases, a pleasant amount of cortisol is released. Ideally, I will wake up of my own accord. When it comes to sleep, Matthias is unbelievably sensitive to light, so he always wears a mask. Because he blocks out the daylight completely, his melatonin level doesn't drop as quickly in the morning. Artificial darkness is just as confusing for our circadian rhythm as artificial light. Our modern world has plenty of both, which upsets our body clock. My hypothesis is that Matthias wouldn't need such a horrible alarm clock if he simply stopped wearing his sleep mask. Matthias thinks that his melatonin system is simply too sensitive and that he wouldn't get enough sleep without this quilted thing across his face. What hampers both our arguments is that melatonin may not actually be a sleep hormone. For example, nocturnal animals also experience an increase in their melatonin levels at night, which would make it more of a wake-up hormone. Laboratory mice often produce little melatonin at all due to a genetic mutation, and yet their sleep is perfectly normal. Plot twist! So does that mean melatonin doesn't make us tired? Well, on the other hand, many studies have shown that melatonin helps to treat insomnia and chronically delayed sleep. So what now? Sleep researchers are yet to agree on the exact link between melatonin and sleep. As long as it remains unclear whether melatonin really makes us tired, Matthias and I can carry on debating the usefulness of his sleep mask. Now, before you listen to the rest of this book, there's something I really need you to know. If you want to understand science, you need to lose the habit of looking for simple answers. This might sound arduous at first, but I promise that scientific thinking doesn't make the world drier. In fact, it makes it more colorful and literally full of wonder. So let's start by agreeing that melatonin isn't a sleep hormone, but more of a night hormone that translates what the eyes can see, encroaching darkness, into the body. A long-term experiment could shed some light on our personal melatonin dispute and on Matthias's retina. Unfortunately, experiments with two participants are not statistically viable, so debate remains our only option. I go into the kitchen to make myself a coffee. When you get up, you should ideally wait an hour before drinking your first coffee. Your morning boost of cortisol is your body's own way of waking up. Caffeine also encourages the body to produce cortisol. Great, you might think. I'll simply up my morning cortisol level with a coffee. Unfortunately, or luckily, our bodies don't work like that. They like balance. Bear in mind that as time goes on, your body will acclimate to that coffee boost by reducing its own morning stress service. So it's better to wait until your body's own cortisol boost has leveled out again, which takes about an hour, before adding coffee into the mix. Right now, I feel like all my morning cortisol has been wiped out in the space of a minute. I reach for the coffee to fight the tiredness I can already feel creeping up on me. So, provided you're not feeling too hot already, grab yourself a coffee, tea, or hot beverage of your choice to drink as you listen. There's nothing better than a hot drink to help you see the world in molecules. If I put my steaming cup of coffee on the table in front of me, before long, the part of the table under the cup will warm up too. And if I wait even longer, the coffee will eventually go cold. Have you ever asked yourself where the heat actually goes? This puts us right in the middle of one of my favorite topics, the particle model. It might not sound particularly exciting at first, but I guarantee you'll be fascinated. According to the particle model, every substance in the universe is made up of particles. They might be atoms, they might be molecules. Conveniently, the particle model doesn't even need to know what these particles look like. Despite this extremely simplified way of looking at things, we can use the model to describe some parts of our world amazingly well, like my coffee, for instance. So when I drink a coffee, I'm drinking coffee particles, or tea particles, depending on your beverage of choice. Let's imagine that these particles are like tiny balls invisible to the naked eye. In reality, they are mainly water molecules, with a bit of caffeine and a few other molecules, like flavoring agents. These particles are constantly moving. You can actually see this movement, despite not being able to see molecules with the naked eye. But how? Simple. Take a glass of tap water and add a drop of coffee. Ink works even better. But if you're drinking coffee anyway, even if the glass is on the table, not moving, it's only a matter of time before the drop of coffee disperses throughout the water, even if you don't stir it. Watching this happen might not blow your mind, but think about what's actually happening in this tranquil glass of water. It's a buzzing party, a chaotic glass of swarming, wriggling particles. And I'd like to invite you to this invisible particle party. This is where the chemistry begins. Incidentally, the glass, the coffee cup, the table, the floor on which it stands, the air, and of course you and I, are all made up of particles. And they are moving too. It's practically impossible for them to be still. At this precise moment, a particle party is taking place wherever you look. In your cup, beneath your feet, and in your body. It's just that you can't see it. Now, you might ask what the point is of imagining a world made up of lots of tiny particles when we can't even see them. Aside from the fact that it's just a cool idea, at least I think it is. The point is this. You can use it to explain, for example, how the different states of matter, solid, liquid, and gas, are formed. Whether a substance is a solid, liquid, or gas depends on how much the particles are moving. My coffee cup is solid because its particles only move a little. They are connected to one another via molecular bonds. We'll discuss chemical bonds in detail later on, but for now, let's compare the molecular situation to a concert with a tightly packed crowd. You can barely move at all, but still, you jump around as best you can. This is a good representation of the particles in a solid object like a coffee cup. The liquid inside the cup, the coffee, the particles are a little more mobile, even if there is still a high level of interaction. At the aforementioned concert, we would now be in the mosh pit, right in front of the stage, where everyone goes wild and throws themselves around. The gaseous air molecules, the ones we're breathing, are the wildest of all. They move without any regard for their fellow molecules. You would have to make the concert venue a couple of times larger so that everyone in the audience could run around freely and turn somersaults without getting in each other's way. Water shows us that to switch between states of matter, we have to change the temperature. If we heat up solid water, ice, then it melts into a liquid. If we continue to heat it, the water vaporizes and becomes a gas. If the water vapor then hits a cool surface, like a bathroom mirror, it condenses and returns to liquid form. If we cool the water further, it freezes into ice. Why am I telling you something you already know? Because I'm going to blow your mind! Temperature is nothing more than the movement of particles. The hotter, the faster. The slower, the colder. Isn't it cool to have a molecular definition of temperature? Isn't that much more satisfying than reading the temperature from a thermometer? If you look back at your steaming cup of coffee, everything makes a lot more sense. The coffee is hot, which means that the water molecules are moving quickly and bumping into one another. The molecules that are evaporating are so quick and need so much space that their sheer need for movement makes them leave the cup and enter the gaseous phase. So how does the heat of the coffee transfer to the cup, and from there to the kitchen table? Heat conduction works through particle collisions and the transfer of kinetic energy. The coffee particles speed around the cup, constantly bumping into the sides. Like bumper cars, the cup particles also start to move more and vibrate faster. The cup particles collide with the particles in the kitchen table and cause them to vibrate faster as well. And because heat always conducts toward whatever is colder, the table grows warmer underneath the cup. Now, we can also see why the coffee eventually goes cold, for the same reason that a pendulum eventually stops moving. As with bumper cars, the particles slow each other down with every collision, until they all return to room temperature, or room speed. All particles and the universe as a whole, with everything it contains, follow the first law of thermodynamics. Here, we can compare this with the law of conservation of energy, which states that energy cannot be created or destroyed, but can only be transformed. To put it another way, the total amount of energy always remains the same. If a particle increases in energy, the same amount of energy must be lost somewhere else. If a particle transfers some of its kinetic energy to another particle when they collide, and the other particle becomes faster as a result, then the first particle must slow down. If this didn't happen, it would be as though energy had been created from nothing. And that isn't possible. The destruction of energy also goes against the law of thermodynamics. Some physicists and chemists get really annoyed when people talk about wasting energy. If you know any physicists or chemists, give it a try. Before we continue through my day, I have one last thought experiment involving the particle model, perhaps the most interesting one of all. Touch the objects around you. Some will feel warmer, others colder. But every object in a closed room has the same temperature, room temperature. So why does a metal spoon feel colder than a wooden table? Well, one thing in the room isn't at room temperature, and that's your body. Your body temperature is higher than room temperature. At least, I hope so for your sake. What you feel when you touch a spoon or a wooden table is, in fact, your own body heat. If this heat is conducted away from you quickly, the object feels cold. If it's conducted away slowly, the object feels warm. When I pick up the spoon, my hand particles collide with the spoon particles and cause them to vibrate. The faster the spoon's metal atoms vibrate, the warmer the spoon becomes. Metal is a good heat conductor. When the metal particles make contact with my finger particles, the movement travels well through the spoon. Metal is a good heat conductor because of its chemical bond. We'll discuss this further in Chapter 8. For now, picture the bonds in the metal as a jungle gym made from ropes. If a child starts climbing and jumps onto or shakes one of the ropes, the movement will quickly spread throughout the whole jungle gym. If there's another child on the other side of the jungle gym, they'll be shaken as well. At the same time, the movement of the jumping child is curbed by the law of conservation of energy. When the child transfers their kinetic energy to the ropes and to the other child, they themselves become slower. Their movement is curbed. In terms of thermodynamics, this means that the child becomes slower, with less energy, so colder. The jungle gym could also be made from solid poles. If the child jumps onto a pole, it won't have much impact on another child on the same structure. The child's own movements will barely be curbed or transferred elsewhere, so the child will become faster and warmer. This kind of jungle gym is like a poor heat conductor, such as wood. If you place your hand on a wooden table, only the wood particles in direct proximity to your hand will vibrate. The vibration and movement don't travel so well through the rest of the wood, so it feels warmer than the metal spoon. If temperature is nothing more than the movement of particles, this makes it easier to visualize the second law of thermodynamics, which states that heat always flows from something warm to something cold, and never the other way around. If you put a bottle of cola in an ice bucket, the cold from the ice doesn't flow into the bottle. In fact, the exact opposite happens. The warmth from the bottle flows into the ice cubes, which warm up, and this is how the bottle cools down. Now that you know this, listen out for the next person who says, "Close the window, the cold's getting in." Instead of leaving this thermodynamic baloney unchecked, say, "I think you mean the heat's getting out." And if it starts to bug you when people talk about wasting energy, then you'll fit right in with the nerds. Congratulations, your introduction to physical chemistry is complete. Hopefully before you've even finished your coffee. Matisse comes into the kitchen and strokes my hair apologetically. "Sorry, I forgot to tell you I was going running today." "It's fine," I say. "I need to adjust my sleep pattern again anyway." Although I know better in theory, I love to sleep late on weekends, which leaves me with social jet lag. Obviously, my circadian rhythm can't tell the difference between weekdays and weekends. Weekends are great, but they are a modern social construct that means nothing to our bodies. Our natural melatonin level is more or less based on the sun. And yet, I'm exhausted when the sun rises and end up going to bed far too late. My life of coffee, artificial light, and awful alarm clocks is constantly confusing my body with false stimuli. Researchers have observed that after a week of camping with no coffee, artificial light, or cell phones, a person's melatonin cycle readjusts to solar time. It's just a shame I don't like camping. One thing is truly strange. Theoretically, our biological clock works without light, too. On this planet with 24-hour days, our biological clocks have evolved to follow 24-hour days as well, with only minor variations. The light helps us to set our biological clock, to synchronize the days, and to adjust to jet lag, for example. In 2017, the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine was awarded to three American researchers who revealed the workings of our biological clocks. They kept fruit flies in two different chambers labeled New York and San Francisco, with staged lighting based on the solar rhythms of these two coastal cities. The fruit flies were repeatedly flown in an airplane, a glass, to the other city. The researchers observed how the flies coped with the 3-hour time difference. They discovered that two different genes are essential to our biological clocks. Genes are where chemistry gets really exciting. Our DNA not only is a molecule in its own right, but also ensures the production of other molecules vital to life. All the information we need to live is coded in our genes, including information about our biological clock. This code can be read and translated when these genes produce proteins. In other words, the genes have the plan, and the proteins implement the plan. Proteins are highly shrewd molecules that will come up throughout the book. So the two clock genes produce two clock proteins. Initially, both proteins increase in concentration, but then they combine to form one unit. Teaming up allows them to carry out the plan made by the genes, to inhibit their own production. That's right, these proteins are produced to stop their own production, to stop their own genes from being read. Similar to cortisol and stress, what we have here is a negative feedback loop. If no more clock proteins are produced, their concentration decreases further. Eventually, the protein concentration drops so low that the reading of the genes can no longer be restricted, and the protein production starts from scratch. This whole cycle takes almost exactly 24 hours. Day and night are coded in our genes. I get the feeling that something isn't right with my genes. I'm convinced that my body is designed for a 30-hour day. I need much longer days and a lot more sleep. I'd like to get myself checked out.
I have to go, says Matthias.
My cell phone vibrates. I'm surprised to see a message from Christine. She's awake already? I think Jonas is dead, she writes. I'll call in a second, I reply. Already dressed for running, Matthias sticks his head around the open door and asks if he needs to take a key. No, I say. Close the door, the heat's getting out. 2. Death by toothpaste. Where are you? I ask Christine when she finally answers her cell. On my way to the lab. She sounds annoyed. So what's going on with Jonas? I've just left his place, she huffs. So did you spend the night with him? How? She interrupts me. Mai, he uses natural toothpaste. What? Without fluoride. Oh, crap. Jonas is a really sweet physicist Christine has been seeing for a few weeks. We've actually known him for quite a long time through our friend Hans, who's also a physicist. Although Jonas is extremely good-looking, Christine was never particularly interested in him. I would describe her as sapiosexual. She's only attracted, emotionally and physically, to intelligent people. So when Hans told us that Jonas was a real brainiac and came top of the class every semester, Christine was suddenly hot for him. Which makes it even more alarming that he uses toothpaste without fluoride. Are you sure? I ask. Maybe it was just the tube. They all try to market themselves as organic these days. I mean, there are herbal toothpastes that contain fluoride. No, it clearly said no fluoride. And I read a list of ingredients as well. Okay. So what did it contain if there was no fluoride? What was the substitute? That's not the point, Christine interjects. Oh dear. It must be serious if she doesn't even feel like ruminating over the ingredients. I'm so turned off. I think Jonas is dead to me. Death by toothpaste, I think. Ironically, this is exactly what Jonas is afraid of. But did you ask him about it? Maybe he wasn't paying attention when he bought it. He says that fluoride calcifies the pineal gland, but he didn't even know where the pineal gland was. Well, I think to myself, physicists are no chemists. Hydroxyapatite, Christine says suddenly. What? The fluoride substitute in this herbal toothpaste, she snorts. Ridiculous! You mean hydroxyapatite as in tooth enamel? Yes, how is that even allowed? Interesting, I say. Please make a video about it, says Christine. I'm at the lab now. Speak to you later. Thinking about it, a video about fluorides and toothpaste would be a great idea. Many people find it odd that I studied chemistry and completed a doctorate, only to end up doing something in the media. But I do it with conviction. Laboratory research isn't the only way for a scientist to help humanity. Talking about science is just as important. It's pretty damn difficult for laypeople to find scientific information that is both understandable and correct. The internet
is full of. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.